AS 10, accounting for fixed assets. So we are going to learn this standard under these captions, meaning initial recognition of fixed assets, subsequent expenditure, the repairs expenditure, the improvement expenditure, addition to the assets, and then we have revaluation, retirement and disposal, special issues like joint ownership, consolidated purchases, higher purchase assets. So these are the various issues that we are going to learn through this standard AS 10, accounting for fixed assets. Normally any asset, when we learn accounts, there are three aspects only. It is the purchases, sale, valuation. We have few more issues in relating to fixed asset like revaluation, subsequent expenditure and additions. So these things we like to discuss one by one. First, what is fixed asset? Investment is an asset held by an enterprise for earning income. Fixed asset is any asset held by an enterprise for usage. Held for usage, not for sale. So these are the two primary points that you should be knowing, that it is held for usage and not for sale, and which has life more than one accounting period. Which is having life more than one accounting period, usually we consider them as fixed assets. Shall we proceed? So fixed assets, the meaning of fixed assets means any asset held for usage. It is any asset held for usage, not for sale. Then only it is having life more than one accounting period. Understood? If the accounting period is 15 months, it is more than 15 months. Understood? So thereby, it is an any asset held by an enterprise for usage, not for sale, having life more than one accounting period, is called fixed assets. This standard AS 10 is not applicable to, rather than conveying, it is applicable to, I told you, accounting standard generally covers five aspects: applicability, the scope, recognition, measurement, presentation and disclosure. So rather than saying it is applicable to, it says that it is not applicable to. It is not applicable to forest and plantation. It is not applicable to forest and plantation. Suppose you were engaged in cultivating trees, or maybe mango farm. All these things are assets to you. A mango tree is an asset to you. When you are having a mango farms, then each of the mango tree is an asset. But this standard is not applicable for such assets, fixed asset. Understood? They are also fixed assets only. Mango tree is not to be sold. Understood? Only mangoes only will be sold. Could you appreciate that? So thereby we find that you can't take mango tree as current asset. Mango tree should be your fixed asset, which generates income for you. Every year generates income for you. Correct? But it need not be accounted as per AS 10. Shall we proceed? So thereby, forest and plantation, then wasting assets such as oil well coal mines, these are all also fixed assets. Respond? Yes, sir. And from which we extract oil, as and when we extract oil, the value of fixed asset reduces. That are all okay, but not to be accounted as per AS 10. Could you appreciate that? So this standard is not applicable to, because in past, in one or two examination, they were asking AS 6 not applicable, or state any four item for which AS 6 not applicable, state any 2-3 items for which AS 10 not applicable. Like that, there will be questions. Could you appreciate that? So understood? Real estate development, the land and any other activity connected to the real estate development shouldn't be considered in accordance with AS 10. Understood? Respond. Then livestock, cattle, understanding? So all these things, sir, that is current asset only. No, we are holding it for sale. No, see, we may have cow, We are not going to sell the cow, we are going to sell only milk. Please respond. In that case, the cow is our asset. So AS 10 is not applicable to these four type of categories of assets, even though they may be fixed assets. Correct? So it is forest and wasting assets such as oil well, coal mines, real estate developments, livestock. Understood? Fine. Now let us move forward. Let us understand now initial recognition. Shall we proceed? Other than this, generally for any form of fixed asset, the standard is applicable and you will go for accounting in accordance with the standard. Shall we proceed?
Yes, sir.
Pakka?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we are just going to learn initial
recognition.
When the asset is initially recognized as an asset, what is the amount that you should assign? The quantum of amount to be assigned is what we have to discuss now. Shall we proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, when we initially recognize the fixed asset in our books, the quantum to be assigned is what we are going to discuss under initial recognition. Fixed asset can arise in two ways. Either they will construct their own fixed assets. They will construct their own fixed assets. Respond. Or it is acquired. It is not that always fixed assets are acquired. Many enterprises will construct their own fixed asset. It can't be bought from outside. It's highly a confidential information that they keep about the information about fixed assets. Are you following up? In fact, it is closely connected to their products, end product. Are you following up? So thereby, please understand. So there will be self-constructed fixed assets, acquired fixed assets. Usually we think that goods only either will be bought or manufactured. Fixed assets and all we always buy. No. So fixed assets also can be constructed. Also it can be acquired. Shall we proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If the asset is self-constructed, if the asset is, then it shall be recognized that you should consider all directly attributable cost. All directly attributable cost and allocated cost. All directly attributable cost and allocated cost. So what is that? All directly attributable cost, material, labor, overheads. Respond. For this also you require material, you require labor, you need which is directly attributable. There are certain expenses which cannot be directly attributable, it is only allocated. Certain general or certain administrative overheads. Are you following this? So it can only be allocated. I have a factory manager, a supervisor who supervises the production activities, production of goods, manufacturing of goods in our business, correct? For whom a monthly salary of 50,000 was fixed. Now in a particular month, 15 days was devoted, his time, 15 days was devoted to the construction of this fixed asset. Please respond.
Yes, sir.
Whether this construction is there or not, definitely we are going to pay him 50,000 salary. Please respond. And we will be charging along with the cost of production of goods.
Yes, sir.
Now, a portion of that 1 month salary will be allocated to the cost of fixed assets. It is not directly attributable, it is only allocated. Correct? Material labor exclusively only for the purpose of construction, then it is directly attributable. Those that can be incurred in general and in some portion is relating to fixed assets, now it will be allocated. That way we have two components, directly attributable cost. Then it mentions one more point there, that it should exclude internally generated profit. Internally generated profit should be excluded. I don't have space there, please write. Internally generated profits shall be excluded. internally generated profit shall be excluded. Now what happens means, when we take group 2 topic like branch accounts and department accounts, what chapter? Say head office, when they are transferring goods to branch, they may book some profit. One department of the business transferring goods to another department, they may book some profit, even though it is not a profit for overall business. Are you following? Respond, va.
Yes, sir.
We have a business. Head office is there. Branch is there. Head office makes sales to outsiders. Branch also makes sales to outsiders. But for branch to make sales to outsiders, head office sent goods to branch. Are you following this? So that transfer is not actually earning us any profit. We are transferring goods to our branch is not earning us any profit. But to measure the efficiency of head office and branch separately, we book internally some profits, notional profit. Please respond. Now, 100 rupees is the price at which head office purchased the goods. How much?
100.
It is transferring such goods to the branch at 110. Branch will sell for 125. Branch will sell for? So, head office purchased for? Transferred to branch at 110, and it is getting sold for. So branch, when it is selling, book a profit of 15 rupees. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now what happens? Head office transferred the material to
branch
at 110. Branch is consuming that material for construction of its own fixed asset. Say the head office at Delhi, the branch is at Chennai. The Chennai branch is using that material for construction of fixed assets. Understood? In that case, in that fixed asset, material cost to be included.
Yes,
material cost to be included? No.
Yes,
for branch, they know the cost only as 110. No.
Yes,
everybody.
Yes,
so there could be a possibility that they are including 110 there. Now, AS10 interference says that internally generated shall not be included in the cost of fixed asset, which means you should take the material only at 100. Understood? For accounting purpose, you do any form of accounting. 100, transfer, 110. You book a profit. Profit of 10. Let the branch book a profit of 15 if it is selling to outsiders. Now, okay. But when it is used in the construction of fixed asset, internally generated profit shouldn't be. Suppose an outsider who manufactures the goods for 100, selling to you for 110, and you are paying cash of 110, in that case material will be included in your fixed asset at 110 only. Understood? But if it is internally generated, internally transferred goods, it has to be shown only at the original cost. The internal generated profit shouldn't be included. That is the basic concept. Could you appreciate that? Please respond. So anyway, you can better appreciate this when we take up branch accounts and departmental accounts. So only note is that you should not include internally generated profits. Shall we proceed?
Yes,
respond.
Yes,
so self-constructed. So you should take what and all? All directly attributable costs and allocated cost. Acquired for cash. Understood? So when it is acquired for cash, fixed assets, fixed asset acquired for cash, then at what price it has to be recognized? It is purchase price minus discount, if any. Plus non-refundable duties and taxes. Plus all other costs such as loading, transportation, unloading, installation, etc. All other cost till the asset is, all other costs incurred till the asset is ready to use. Not till the asset is put to use, only till the asset is ready for usage. That's a point you should be knowing. So please understand that all other costs incurred, all other costs incurred, such as loading, transportation, unloading, installation, etc., till the asset is ready for usage. Are you following this? There is a lot of difference between the asset is put to use and asset is ready to use. Are you following this? So we should not take till the asset is put to use. You should take till the asset is ready to use. Shall we proceed? Here, note. Trial run cost also should be included. What cost? Trial run cost. So fixed asset acquired for cash, purchase price minus discount if any, non-refundable duties and taxes. Suppose we are just purchasing one asset, say from Hyderabad we are buying one fixed asset. To bring it to Chennai, it should be loaded into a truck, it should be transported here, it should be unloaded, should be carried to the factory, it has to be installed. Respond. After the installation, it has to be under trial for 1 or 2 days. Respond. Only then we can start our commercial production. Are you following this? Respond. So suppose it is an asset which is manufacturing some car or something, which has to be, for car we have raw materials, correct? So this raw material is usually revenue expense or capital expense? Revenue expense. But even this raw material will also be taken as capital expenditure if it is used in trial run. Are you following? Not for production of the finished goods, just to see whether the machinery is working efficiently or not. Are you following? So normally the labor is a revenue expense. Overheads are revenue expense. But the material, labor, overhead in relation to the trial run of the machinery should be taken as capital expenditure. Are you following this? So these are the points you should be knowing, that all such costs should be added to the asset cost, fixed asset cost. So it is purchase price minus discount if any, as increased by non-refundable duties and taxes. We should be considering non-refundable duties and taxes. What is non-refundable duties and taxes? Which will not be refunded to you. Suppose you are importing an asset from Malaysia. You are paying some tax, you are paying a duty, and that duty is non-refundable. Suppose you are paying VAT for a machinery. You are paying
VAT.
And that VAT can be adjusted against your payment of VAT, then it is refundable nature. It is refundable nature. Could you appreciate that? So please do understand that we should be taking only what duties and taxes? Anyway, at your level, you need not be very clearly knowing it is refundable or non-refundable. They will mention whether it is refundable or
not.
Unless otherwise mentioned, simply given duties and taxes means it is non-refundable. Are you following? So thereby, otherwise government, why should they collect tax? Understood? So unless otherwise specifically mentioned, it is what? Non-refundable. So purchase price minus discount plus then the loading cost, transportation cost, unloading cost, all these things should be capitalized in arriving at the initial recognition value, which is considered as cost of the asset. Historical cost of the asset. To arrive at the historical cost, we should be considering all these costs till the asset is? Suppose the asset is already installed. Already trial run is over. Asset is already
installed.
And already trial run is
over.
Everybody?
Yes, sir.
But we are not using the asset for 3 months. During this 3 months, some maintenance expense incurred. Whether we are using or not, it has to be maintained properly. Some cleaning has to be performed.
Yes, sir.
So in that case, that expense will be revenue or capital? Is it revenue or capital? It's revenue. Suppose this cleaning expense was incurred, the cleaning expense were incurred before it was installed. Then it is capital. So both are cleaning expense only. It's a timing only decide whether it is capital or it's a not the nature. Both the case I told cleaning expense only. But if the cleaning expense incurred before the installation, it is capital expenditure. Are you following? If it is incurred after the installation, which means it is already ready for use, so then it is revenue expenses. Could you appreciate? So you should capitalize all such expenditure till the asset is put to use in ready to use. Understood? This provision, other than cash, is common provision for three accounting standards. Investment accounting, AS10 fixed asset, AS26 intangible asset. We acquire asset in exchange with anything other than cash. In that case, you know the provision, common provision. Can you tell me what should be the value of asset acquired? The fair market value of asset given up. The first priority is actually the fair market value of asset given up. Actually, what you gave only should be the price, not what you acquired. Understood? So fair market value of asset given up or fair market value of asset acquired, whichever is more clearly evident should be the value, correct?
Yes, sir.
Fair market value of assets given up or fair market value of asset acquired, whichever is more clearly evident should be the value. So we have completed meaning, we have completed initial recognition. Subsequent expenditure, these are all small things at different topics of lower level you would have learned. Just confirming all that learning, or we are consolidating all the issues in relation to accounting for fixed asset. Now what do you mean by subsequent expenditure? After the asset was started used, some more expenditure is incurred on the fixed asset. Some repairs expenditure incurred. Respond. Some improvement expenditure incurred. Some repairs expenditure incurred. Now what should we do? What is the treatment of such subsequent expenditure? It is charged to P&L or it is added to cost of the asset? That's very good. If the expenditure increases the efficiency of the asset, it is capitalized. If the expenditure just maintains the efficiency, it is charged to revenue, P&L account. It is expensed. Are you following? So which means subsequent expenditure sometimes unexpected, you can expect case study type questions, sir. Please do aware, please don't go into sleep mode. Basic facts please remember. Understood? Subsequent expenditure. Subsequent expenditure, if increases efficiency, capitalize it. Means what? What do you mean by capitalize it? Added to the cost of the asset. If maintains the efficiency, then expense it. Means what? Charge it to P&L. So capitalize means added to cost of the asset. Expense means charged to P&L. This is a treatment for subsequent expenditure. Everybody? Additions to existing fixed asset. Addition to existing fixed asset means it is not mere repairs expenditure. It is a new addition to the existing asset or an extension of the existing asset. You are creating a new asset which is not physically separated. It is physically connected to the existing asset. Everybody? In a non-AC car, we are fixing AC. AC is a separate asset. Now, it is not physically existing, it is connected to the car. Please respond.
Yes, sir.
Like that, in a machinery, we are incorporating or integrating with a chip, computer chip. Not potato chips. Computer chip. To function it in a very efficient manner. Understood? It is like a robot type. We are just acquired from Japan and we are just integrated into the existing machinery setup. Respond. So addition to existing fixed asset means what, Bob? It is not merely a repairs expenditure. Listen. It is not merely a repairs expenditure. It is physically an addition to existing fixed asset. But it's an asset. The question is, discussion is what means. Should I recognize in the books as separate asset? Or should I add to the book value of existing asset? Do you follow the discussion? There was an existing fixed asset. We are making one more addition to the existing fixed asset. Physically, they are not separated. In the books, should it be separated or should be shown in the existing fixed asset? Books, book value. For that, we should know whether the addition is an integral part or non-integral part. Integral part or non-integral part. Addition to existing fixed asset. So if it is integral part, then capitalize with existing fixed asset. The same provision we'll be discussing in AA6 also. At that time you should be remembering this. Non-integral part means recognized as a separate asset. Recognized as a separate asset. Even though physically it is with the existing asset, in the books it is shown as a separate asset. Car, AC, separately we are showing in the books. Are you following? So if it is integral part, then what I should do? Capital is with the existing asset. If it is non-integral part, non-integral part, what should we do? Show it as a separate asset. Now, what is integral? Sir, please understand. In both the cases, it has been physically attached to the existing asset. Otherwise, we will never discuss this. If it is going to be an independent asset, no discussion. Correct, Abba? Physically, it is an addition to the existing asset. It is an extension of the existing asset. But the question is, in the books, should I show it separately or addition to the existing asset? Are you following this? Please understand the discussion very clearly, my dear students. It is like this. We have an already existing asset. We are also having an addition to the existing asset. Now two assets exist. Now physically both are attached. In the books, the new asset should be shown as a separate asset or should be shown as an addition to the existing asset. Is the discussion. Understand the discussion very clearly. Now answer. What is the answer? If it is integral part, blue. If it is integral part, then add to the existing asset. If it is non-integral, then it should be shown as a separate asset. Now only one thing I should know. What is integral? What is non-integral? Understood? If it lose life, then it is integral part. Even though individually it is having a life of, but the moment it is fixed to one asset, thereafter it cannot be used in another asset. It is like that particular example only. The moment machinery expired, that chip will also expire. It will not go to another fixed asset. Understood? So in that case, that chip, even though having an individual life, the moment attached to an asset, thereafter it is having the life of that existing asset, then it is called what, sir?
Integral
part. Understood? In that case, even though chip is a separate asset, even though chip is having a separate life, but it should be shown as an addition to machinery only. Respond.
Yes, sir.
And this chip is an intangible asset. The chip is an
intangible.
But I won't show it as intangible asset, I will show it as addition to machinery only. Please respond.
Yes, sir.
Suppose a chip was acquired and attached to the machinery. After the machinery is disposed of, the chip will be taken and will be attached to
another
machinery. In that case, it is non-integral. First you added to one asset, then remove from that asset and put into another asset. Say book, accounts, we don't do that. So in accounts, what do we show? The chip will be shown as a separate intangible asset. What asset? It's very important, but because category will be different. The one category is fixed assets, tangible asset. Another category is intangible asset. Could you appreciate that? So if there is an addition to existing asset, and if it is integral part, if it is then it should be capitalized to the existing asset. Anvesh, if it is non-integral part, if it is
non-integral,
then it should be shown as a
separate
asset. What is integral? What is
non-integral?
Non-integral means an asset that is capable of usage even after the disposal of the existing asset. It is called a perfect, and thereby you should be showing as a separation. Sir, this is highly confusing area. Simply theoretically you learn the provision, integral part, non-integral part, that's all. Now okay, but what is integral, what is integral, please have clarity. Now if an asset is capable of usage even after the disposal of an existing asset, then it is non-integral. In that case, such addition will be shown as a
separate
asset. Otherwise, it should be added to the existing asset. These are the provisions relating to additions or extension. Correct? Respond. Fixed asset refers to any asset held by an enterprise for usage, not for sale, which is having a life more than one accounting year. This standard is not applicable to forest and plantation, wasting assets, wasting assets like oil well and coal mines, real estate development, livestock. Initial recognition, acquired, self-constructed, directly attributable cost, allocated cost, exclude, internally generated profit, acquired for cash, purchase price minus discount plus non-refundable duties and taxes, all other costs incurred till the asset is ready to use, not put to use, including dash cost, trial run cost, material labor over relating to trial should also be included. Understood? Fine. So then we are discussing subsequent expenditure. If an expenditure increases the dash, then capitalize, otherwise charge to P&L. If an addition is an existing asset is made, if the addition is integral part, capitalize, non-integral, recognize that as separate asset and separately depreciated. Correct? Pakka? Next provision. Revaluation. Now listen. Revaluation. Remaining under simple provision. Revaluation refers to restatement of the value of fixed assets. It is primarily refers to what? Restatement. Restatement of the value of fixed asset to its present fair value. Generally, fixed assets are shown at historical cost. Costless depreciation is called historical cost. But you can show other costs other than the historical cost through an event called revaluation. Revaluation, whatever we are going to discuss here, is not the revaluation what we have discussed in partnership. Partnership revaluation is a form of accounting the profits and
losses
loss and internally getting distributed among partners. Understood? This is a separate event of revaluation which is recognized by AS 10, which is not the revaluation which is covered through partnership. Shall we proceed? There it includes revaluation of all assets as well as all liabilities. Here it is meant only revaluation for which asset? Fixed assets. Not even all the assets. It is only fixed assets. Shall we proceed? When I say restatement, it may be increase or decrease. Increase in the value of asset result into profit. Decrease in the value of asset result into loss. It's very simple common sense. If it is increase, then it is profit. If it is decrease, it is loss. What is the basic balance of fixed asset, debit or credit? Fixed asset means debit or credit?
Debit.
If I want to increase that, I should?
Debit.
If I want to reduce that?
Credit.
So very clear. I want to revalue upward. Dash the asset.
Debit
the asset. I want to revalue downward.
Credit
the asset. Clear? Sorry. But debit, credit, clear. One part is clear, sir. What is the other part? Shall we? Please respond. If the asset is revalued upward, it is resulting into what, sir? Then the entry will be debit the asset. Respond. Fixed asset debit to revaluation reserve. It is not credited to partner's capital, proprietor's capital, shareholder's fund. Like that it will not be taken. It will be credited to a separate account called revaluation reserve. Understood? If the asset is revalued upward and it is resulting into profit, credit, revaluation reserve. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Pakka?
Yes, sir.
If the revaluation is resulting into loss, then it is credit fixed assets. Understood? Debit, profit and loss account. Rather than conservatism concept, it is actually working with along with the realization concept. The profit can be recognized, gain can be recognized only when the gain is realized. Only when the gain is?
Yes.
When I say recognized means, sir, then you are not recognizing here. I am not recognizing in my P&L. Please respond. I am just restating the value of asset. I am creating a reserve. That is not a gain recognition, which is available for dividend purpose. Could you appreciate that? So thereby, here, the moment you see loss, whether the loss is recognized, the loss is realized or not realized, you should book that loss. Understood? Please respond.
Yes.
So your gain can be recognized only if it is realized. Understood? So basically it comes from a concept called realization concept. Along with that supporting concept is conservatism concept that provide for all possible losses. Anticipate no gains. Provide for all possible losses, but anticipate no gains. Understood? Please respond. Anyway, now coming back to this accounting, we find that it is fixed asset debit to revaluation reserve. If it is decreasing the asset?
No.
If it is increasing the asset? If there is decrease, then loss is debited to P&L. Understood? Profit means credit? Credit? Revaluation reserve. Loss means
debit
P&L. The other portion is fixed asset. So entry now. Profit. Loss. P&L to? Okay. P&L account is used when there is dash.
Loss.
Revaluation reserve is used when there is?
Loss.
Fixed asset account is credited when?
Loss.
Loss. Fixed asset account is debited when?
Loss.
So any form you can answer this question. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Pakka?
Yes, sir.
Shall we proceed?
Yes,
so this is a basic accounting treatment for what, sir?
Yes,
revaluation of fixed asset. Revaluation means restatement. Increase or decrease. Increase means profit. Decrease means loss. Profit means credit. Revaluation reserve. Loss means
debit,
profit and loss account. The loss will be shown in the P&L. Profit means asset is increased. reserve is increased. In the balance sheet only, it won't go to P&L only. Clear? Pakka? Fine. But now there is another discussion we have. Subsequent revaluation. Effect of subsequent revaluation. Shall we, sir? The last few areas. Subsequent revaluation. Sir, what do you mean by subsequent revaluation? An asset which was previously is once again revalued. Simple common sense only. Correct? Subsequent revaluation. An asset previously revalued. Once again revalued. Correct? Sir, you revalue 2 times or 3 times or 5 times. But effect will be same, no? No. When it is subsequent revaluation, then if it is same result of previous revaluation, means original treatment. If it is different treatment than the first revaluation, then reverse the effect of first revaluation, then provide the original revaluation. Confusion. Now listen carefully. Now listen. Subsequent revaluation is actually based on first time revaluation result. Correct? Yes, sir. First time revaluation result. Imagine profit. Respond. Yes, sir. First time revaluation is loss. Like the two scenarios possible. Now subsequent revaluation can be again or it could be loss. Or here, first time was loss, second time loss, profit. Shall we proceed? So which means second time revaluation, second time or two or more, third time revaluation, then you have 4 possibilities. You have now profit, previously profit, or previously loss. Now loss, previously like that, 4 possibilities. Correct, Abba? Please respond.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Now one thing. First time was profit. What was the accounting entry? Please listen. Fixed asset account debit to revaluation reserve. Subsequent time? Profit. Subsequent time also profit. Once again, do the same only. Fixed asset to revaluation reserve. First time profit, revaluation reserve. Second time also profit. Same treatment. Don't do any change. Original treatment. Original treatment is what? Profit means revaluation reserve. Loss means debit P&L account. Understood? So first time profit, fixed asset to revaluation reserve. Second time also profit, fixed asset to revaluation reserve. Is that clear? Pakka? Now listen. First time profit. Second time? I will give some numbers so that you will appreciate the provision better. First time profit entry was fixed asset to revaluation reserve. Say 10 rupees in lakhs. Second time revaluation is also profit. Profit which is 14 lakhs. So fixed asset to revaluation reserve 14. Now in that case, can you tell me what is the revaluation reserve balance? What is the revaluation reserve balance? 24, not 14. Revaluation reserve balance is 24. First time also 10. Now also another revaluation profit. So profit will accumulate. In which account? Revaluation reserve account. Understood? And the profit is totally how much? 24 lakhs. Romanala kaanum pola irukku? Okay, fine. Now first time was profit. So fixed asset to revaluation reserve how much? 10 lakhs. Everybody? Second time there is a loss of 14 lakhs. In that case, if loss means what is the original treatment? Debit P&L. But this standard says don't immediately debit P&L. Reverse the profit position what you already booked. And then still loss exists. Debit P&L. Understand the provision? So easy only. First time there was a profit, no? Now there is a loss, no? Whatever profit that you unnecessarily booked, you reverse it. But that is not sufficient, sir. Still I have loss. then give original treatment for loss. What is the original treatment of loss? Debit P and L. So in that case, what is entry? Now listen, please listen. First of all, loss means credit fixed asset with 14. What I have to debit means this profit what I created in the previous year, no? Or some other year in the past, correct? That will be debited. Revaluation reserve 10. P&L 4. Everybody? So thereby, when subsequent revaluation occurs, everybody? Reverse the effect of the past revaluation. Reverse the effect of the past revaluation, and for the remaining provide the original effect. What is the original effect? Profit means? Profit means credit revaluation reserve. Loss means debit profit loss. This is the original treatment. Correct? But in the subsequent time when you do that, see what happened in the past. See what happened in the past. Understood? So first time profit, now also profit. What is the entry pa? Fixed asset to revaluation reserve. Everybody. First time profit, now loss. First time profit, now
loss.
What is it I should do? First debit revaluation reserve. Then further a loss, if any, debit profit and loss account. Clear? Credit fixed assets. Pakka? Everybody? Sorry. Individual question, pa. You only should answer. First time profit, 10 lakhs. Entry. No. Individual question. Yes.
Fixed asset to revaluation.
Fixed asset to revaluation reserve. Correct? Sir, please stop talking. Now, second time revaluation. Loss, 7 lakhs.
Revaluation
reserve. How much amount? 7 or 10? 7. 2 fixed assets? 7, that's all. So thereby it is not that when I say reverse the effect, then immediately first time whatever amount you have shown, simply debit it. You don't do that. First time there is a profit of 10 lakhs. Entry was? Fixed asset to? Revaluation reserve. How much? 10 lakhs. Second time there is a loss of? 7 lakhs. At that time, sir, only to loss, now reverse the original effect. So debit revaluation reserve 10 lakhs. Why should I do that? When there is a loss only to the extent of 7 lakhs. Reverse revaluation reserve only for
7 lakhs.
Understood? So revaluation reserve 7 lakhs. 2 fixed assets 7 lakhs. Which means after that entry, still there will be a balance of 3 lakhs in the revaluation reserve. Suppose the loss was 11 lakhs. 11 lakhs. Then revaluation reserve 10 lakhs, P&L 1 lakh, 2 fixed assets 11 lakhs. Understood? Many times they will ask simple 2 entries for 4 marks. Original revaluation, subsequent revaluation. Correct, you make the reversal effect, 4 marks. Let do entries. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
Pakka? Fine. So this is how we are just making the revaluation entries. So you should be knowing the first time effect as well as subsequent effect. Shall we? First time loss, what is the entry? P&L to fixed assets. P&L to fixed asset. Clear? 10. Second time also loss, 14. P&L to fixed asset. How much? 14. Now another scenario, fourth scenario. First time loss, 10, that is P&L to fixed asset, 10 lakhs. Second time profit of 14 lakhs. Fixed asset debit 14. 2, P&L 10. Whatever loss that you have already booked should be reversed. Anikanda? Everybody? Then still I have profit. Now I don't credit P&L. I will credit what? Revaluation reserve. How much? 4 lakhs. Clear? Pakka? So whenever there is profit and subsequent profit, original effect. Loss, subsequent loss, original effect. Profit, subsequent loss, reverse the profit. For further loss, debit P&L. I have profit. Previously loss. Previously
loss.
Reverse the loss. Then original effect, credit what?
Revaluation
reserve. This is the point you should be knowing. Clear? Pakka?
Yes,
so definite, they will give. An asset was revalued upward in so and so year. So now let us take retirement and disposal. Retirement and disposal. There are two issues in that. One is an asset retired and held for disposal. The other one is disposal. Disposal is an event. So retired and held for disposal. I mean, disposal is a transaction. This is an event. So two issue. Retired and held for disposal. An asset was retired and held for disposal, which means we already discussed this when I took schedule 6. An asset is withdrawn from active use. It is not at all getting used now. It is to be sold, but on the balance sheet it so far I have not sold, but it is not in the usage now. It is only intention is to sell. Please respond. So an asset is withdrawn from usage and it is held for sale. That is what? Disposal. Are you following? Retired and held for disposal. Usually fixed asset will be shown at dash. No, classification will be that we have discussed already in schedule 6. Correct? Usually it is shown at dash value. Historical cost, which is costless accumulated depreciation, which is the book value. Everybody, generally we don't show at the realizable value of the asset. It will be shown only at historical cost less depreciation. Clear? But once an asset is retired and held for, it should be valued at the net book value or net realizable value, whichever is less. Such fixed assets are to be valued at net book value or net realizable value, whichever is less. Suppose the original cost of the asset is 50 lakhs. So far depreciation charged was 48 lakhs. Means what? Net book value is 2 lakhs. It is expected to be sold for 2.5 lakhs. So far not sold. Expected to be sold for 2.5 lakhs. Then I will show in my balance sheet at 2 lakhs, which is costless depreciation. But we expect that asset to be sold only for 1.5 lakhs. Then it will be shown at only 1.5 lakhs. Understood? Please respond. So, but in our books it is presently at, I will value it. So the loss on valuation will be charged to P&L immediately, even before sale. The loss on valuation should be shown, will be charged to P&L immediately, even though the asset was not sold. Understood? Please respond.
Yes, sir.
An asset is in use, having a book value of 2 lakhs, 50 lakhs, 40 lakhs depreciation, 2 lakhs book value. Respond.
Yes, sir.
It is expected to be sold for 1.5 lakhs. It is expected to be sold for as on the balance sheet date. Now it will be shown at 2 lakhs or 1.5 lakhs. I said the asset was in use and the net book value is 2 lakhs. Now today if I sell this asset, I will get 1.5 lakhs. I should show the asset at 2 lakhs. I will not bring this to net realizable value, or I will never consider net realizable value as long as asset is in
use.
Only if the asset was withdrawn from active use, it is not at all in use, the only objective of holding that asset is to sell the asset. In that case only I will value the asset at net book value or net realizable value, whichever is less. Otherwise always I will show the asset at historical cost, which is cost minus depreciation. Understood? So significance of the wording you should be knowing. So this provision anyway we know, but this provision you shouldn't apply when the asset is in
use.
Are you following? Whichever is less, all the provision like that only, sir. Question comes and I will answer. But if the question is in use, asset is in use, never you will value this only if the asset is retired and held for disposal. You will apply such a principle for fixed asset. But for inventories, you will always apply the same principle. Understand? Cost or NRV, whichever is less. But fixed asset, as long as they are in use, we always value only at, we don't see the market price. Are you following? But if it is retired and disposed, disposed, you know, valuation will not come. Retired, word important. Retired and disposed. If it is already disposed, this valuation principle will never be applied. Then I will account the profit or loss on sale of asset. If it is already disposed, we are discussing retired. And held for disposal, asset is still there with us. Physically in accounts, both asset is still with us. In that case, what value I should fix is what we are discussing. Understood? So, if the asset is retired and held for disposal, it should be valued at net book value or net realizable value, whichever is less. Is that clear? Pakka? If the asset is disposed, the difference between the net sale value and net book value will be recognized as profit or loss. If the asset is disposed, then the difference between net book value and net sale value and net book value will be recognized as profit or loss. In which place? In P&L. In P&L you will be booking the profit or loss. Now listen, there was an asset which was having a book value of 30 lakhs, was revalued upward by 10 lakhs and it was increased to 40 lakhs. Recognizing revaluation reserve of 10 lakhs. Are you following with the facts? Yes. Explaining facts, pa? Now please listen. So we had an asset whose book value was dash. Was increased to dash by increasing by, which is booking a revaluation reserve of 10 lakhs. Correct? Okay. Imagine no depreciation was charged. No depreciation was charged. Shall we proceed? This asset was sold for 45 lakhs. This asset, after some period, it was sold for 45 lakhs. Respond.
Yes, sir.
In that case, what is the treatment? Discuss the accounting treatment with regard to relevant accounting standard. AS 10. So what is the accounting treatment now? 40 lakhs sold for 45 lakhs. So there is a profit of which will be recognized in balance sheet. Will be recognized in P&L. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Adhu matter illa. The matter is that already we have booked a revaluation reserve of 10 lakhs now.
Yes, sir.
This revaluation reserve should be there in the balance sheet always, is what we told.
Yes, sir.
But the asset itself is now gone out. Yes, asset is fully
gone.
Should I still show the revaluation reserve or should I transfer that?
Transfer.
Do you follow the discussion?
Yes, sir.
So should we still show the revaluation reserve or should I transfer or eliminate revaluation reserve? Obviously, we have to eliminate revaluation. That revaluation reserve arises because of revaluation of one asset. That revaluation reserve arises because of revaluation of one asset. Is that clear? Now, this particular asset itself is not there with us. In that case, this revaluation reserve also should be transferred to which place? It is now realized profit or unrealized profit? originally it was not taken to P&L, It was recognized only as revaluation?
Yes, sir.
Because it was considered as unrealized profit. Now entire cash is realized. You have realized 45 lakhs cash. So in that case, this 10 lakhs is realized or unrealized?
Yes.
Everybody.
Yes, sir.
So thereby it should be transferred to?
Yes.
This standard says that on disposal of asset, the balance in the revaluation reserve shall be transferred to general reserve. Don't transfer to P&L. See, this is not the profit of 1 year or this year profit. It is an accumulated profit of several years. Please respond. In that case, transfer this profit to what?
General
reserve, not to
P&L.
But 5 lakhs will be transferred to?
P&L.
So, first of all, accounting entry is what? Bank debit 40. Bank debit. To fixed asset. To P&L. Adu over. Next, this will be simply transferred to? Entry is? Revaluation reserve to general reserve. That's all. Are you following? So what is the provision ultimately I told? On disposal of a revalued asset. On the balance in the shall be transferred to? Super. That's all. Simple. Are you following? On disposal of a revalued asset. So generally some asset is sold, you get profit or loss by comparing sale value, book value. That's all. Correct? Here also we get profit or loss. That should be recognized in? Here also we are getting profit or loss. That should be recognized in P&L. Then we also have some balance in revaluation reserve. Shall be transferred to general reserve. Is that clear? Pakka? So the basic provision which I am conveying through all this discussion is that on the disposal of a revalued asset, the balance in the revaluation reserve shall be transferred to general reserve. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now let me give you another scenario. This 40 lakhs was sold for 37 lakhs. 40 lakhs was sold for 37 lakhs. Everybody? There is a loss or profit?
Loss.
Now what is the accounting entry I should make? Bank debit 37 lakhs. Credit fixed asset 40 lakhs. Debit revaluation reserve 3 lakhs. So which means what is the provision we are communicating now? On disposal of a revalued asset, if there is any loss, such a loss shall be adjusted against and balance revaluation reserve shall be transferred to general reserve. Understood? On disposal of a revalued asset, if there is profit, profit shall be booked in P&L. Balance in revaluation reserve, general reserve. Second scenario, on disposal of a revalued asset, there is that loss will be adjusted against revaluation reserve. Loss will be adjusted against balance revaluation reserve will be transferred to general reserve. In our example, what is that amount? And amount wise, how do you express? 40 lakhs sold for 37 lakhs. Loss will be adjusted against revaluation reserve. Do you still have balance left? How much you have left in revaluation reserve? 7 lakhs. This will go to general reserve. Understood? So what is the accounting entry for sale? Bank 37. Revaluation reserve 3. 2 fixed asset 40. Then revaluation reserve 7. 2 general reserve 7. This fixed asset was sold for 29 lakhs. This fixed asset was sold for 29 lakhs. Correct? So there is a loss of 11 lakhs. Correct?
Yes,
so now what is accounting entry? Bank debit 29 lakhs. To fixed asset 40 lakhs. There is a loss of 11 lakhs. Debit revaluation reserve 11. 10 lakhs. P&L 1 lakh. On disposal of a revalued asset, if there is loss exceeding the First, the loss will be adjusted against. Further loss will be debited in P under. Then third category. Are you following this? Profit arises. Profit goes to P under. Revaluation reserve goes to? Revaluation reserve goes to? General reserve. Are you following this? Then loss arises. First adjusted against? If you have any balance left in revaluation reserve, goes to general reserve. Third category. Loss adjusted. No balance in revaluation reserve. Full revaluation reserve expired. Exhausted. Now still there is some balance in P&L. Loss. It should go to P&L account. Understand? In the given case, 40 lakhs sold for 29 lakhs. There is a loss of? Adjust against revaluation reserve. Fully exhausted. Still I have loss of 1 lakh. Go to P&L. Okay. So first we individually learn revaluation provision. Then we learn disposal provision. Now we combined both. Correct? Last part. Taka I will complete. Bah. Special issue, sir. Higher purchase asset should be recognized at. Should be recognized at cash price. Just understand that. What is cash price? What is the relevance of that price? All these things. Next chapter we will be learning. Understood? Next chapter is what? Higher purchase transaction. Are you following? So thereby, higher purchased fixed asset shall be recognized at dash price. Cash price. All of that. Understood? Consolidated purchases. Say, what happens? We buy one vehicle, one AC, everybody, one machinery. Machinery, vehicle, computer, AC. Four assets we are purchasing. Respond.
Yes, sir.
Totally we have paid 5 lakhs. Vehicle, it was a car. Then we bought one computer, AC, one machinery. Separate asset. Everybody,
yes,
totally we paid how much? Pa? 5 lakhs. Now this is called what? Consolidated purchases. When the consideration is agreed as a package for group of asset, it is called a dash. Consolidated purchases. Correct? If I buy car saying it is 3 lakhs, I am paying you 3 lakhs for the car. For the machinery, I am paying you 1,20,000. For the computer, say 30,000. For the AC, remaining amount. Like that, very clearly mentioned. Now, that is not called consolidated purchases. When it becomes consolidated purchase, now, I have not fixed any value individually. Naaludhukku say the 5 lakhs. Pa. That's all. Agreed. Understood? We put a towel under the table. We agreed for a price. It was 5 lakhs. Understood? So, that way we find that for all this group of assets together, the consideration is how much? Okay, just because of we acquired all these four assets together, can I show in my balance sheet, since I could not separate this, can I show, say, vehicle, computer, AC, machinery, 5 lakhs? In a one title, I can't show this, correct? Consolidated asset, 5 lakhs. Understood? So you should be showing these assets separately or together? I should be showing these assets. What value is the discussion? I didn't agree na pa 5 lakhs na pa value. Market value, individually I put it comes to 8 lakhs. Market value of these items put together, it comes to? I bought for how much? So I should be showing at 8 lakhs. I should be showing 8 lakhs. What I paid only should be considered as consideration, no? So then the standard says that the consideration should be apportioned in the proportion of fair value. In case of consolidated purchases, the consideration shall be apportioned in the proportion of fair value. Everybody, so please understand, in what is consolidated purchases? The consideration is agreed as a package for group of assets is called consolidated purchases. Correct? In such cases, the consideration will be apportioned in the proportion of fair value of the asset. Identify fair value, definitely it will be more than 5 lakhs. Respond, pa?
Yes,
That is why we bought this group of assets together, correct? So that fair value should be taken as a proportion for apportioning
5 lakhs.
That will be the best deal to show the assets separately. Understood? Please respond.
Yes, sir.
The last item, in case of joint ownership, proportionate share of cost accumulated depreciation. Proportionate share of cost and accumulated depreciation shall be recognized in the balance sheet. That's all. So which means we have built one building jointly with another person. Total worth is around say 5 crores. In that we have contributed 60% of that building. So in our balance sheet, we'll be showing the building at 5 crore. Whatever we, our share of that building, that we'll be showing in our balance sheet. Understood? It shouldn't be like both showing building as 5 crore. Understood? So that shouldn't happen. So in case of joint ownership, their share, respective share, proportionate share should be shown in the balance sheet. So which is the proportionate share of cost and proportionate share of accumulated depreciation shall be shown in the balance sheet. Could you appreciate that? See, these are all the issues, various issues in relation to AS10 accounting for fixed assets. Everybody.